Wouldn't it be great as an overseas basketball player if you knew when leagues were starting, when leagues were stopping, and when potential job opportunities were opening up? Well, luckily for you, I went through all of the major overseas basketball leagues across all the continents, and I looked at their start and stop dates and when potential jobs could be opening up for you. So let's dive into it right now. Now, if you're looking for a short answer on how long the overseas basketball season is, then you're looking at about 7 to 9 months. It will really depend on the continent and what country you're in and what league you're in, the division, obviously. But in general, we can say that the overseas basketball season starts at about 7 to 9 months. And this is traditionally the same way that we would look at North American basketball, starting in about October or so. We have the preseason, September, August, around there, and we go until May or June. Really similar to actually what you see in the NBA. Now, regardless of what continent you're in, whether you're in Asia, the Americas, Europe, it doesn't matter. The top leagues in these divisions and these continents, will always run longer. They will always run in this traditional 7 to 9 month time frame. But when you get to the Americas, for instance, it can vary. There can be some leagues that run for as short as 3 months or 2 months. There's a few leagues in Asia that actually run for 3 or 4 months. But again, this will vary depending on where you are and what continent you're in. So let's take a look at the European system first. Now, Europe is the easiest to answer. It's the easiest to quantify because pretty much everybody in Europe follows the same system, follows the same overseas basketball schedule. They, again, are starting in the traditional basketball season, similar to the NBA. So these guys are starting almost in every league that I saw. They start in late September or early October, and they go until about late May or early June. Now, not only will the top divisions follow this system or this format, such as, you know, Spain's ACB league or Germany's BBL league, but there will also be the lower divisions in the tier system that Europe has. For instance, they have first division, second division, third division, fourth division, all the way to whatever they go to. These lower divisions as well will also follow the same basketball schedule. So when I looked at, for instance, Spain, less 1 month of variance between the Spain's ACB league, which is the top league, and the EBA league in Spain, which is the fourth division. So even though both of these divisions, they have huge variance in budget, experience, players, importance within Spain, they pretty much run at the same schedule. Now, if there is some other league that I'm missing in Europe and you happen to play in Europe or you know someone who played in Europe, please comment below because I'd be curious as to what league that is and if they ran in a different time frame. But the vast majority of Europe runs in this time frame. And not only that, but in Europe as well, they're also going to follow the same in-season schedule, which is really interesting. So even though Europe runs for about 8 to 9 months, they actually don't play as many games as some of the other continents, and it's much more spread out. So pretty much in all the European systems and all the European leagues, they will have practice for 5 days, maybe one game on the weekend, and then they'll have a rest day, and then they'll be back at it. Even though the season is longer, you will be practicing a lot more, and you will be locked in into a longer season. So keep that in mind if you're an overseas player who is interested in playing in Europe. That's something you have to keep in mind because you're going to be there for a long time. That means you can't just bail on your contract and go to another team if another opportunity comes up. That means if you outplayed the money that you earned, you're still going to have to be locked. You're still locked into that contract and you have to finish out the contract. Otherwise, there's going to be huge repercussions by the team, by FIBA. You might be sanctioned. You may not be able to play for a while in overseas basketball. A lot of players will prefer a shorter season because they can get a quick paycheck and then they can up their value and ask for more in the next season. But some players don't want that. Some players want a longer contract because obviously they know that they don't have to worry about what they're going to do after the contract is over. They don't have to worry about maybe getting a second job when they get back home because they know that I have this steady stream of income for 9 months rather than a player who played in another division or another continent. They may only play for 3 or 4 months and then you're home and there's a 4 or 5 month break in between until the next season. What are you going to do during that time for money? That's something you have to consider. So this is why it's really important that players understand the overseas basketball schedule and how long the overseas basketball schedule is in each continent so that they can prepare accordingly and not only how they message teams, not only when they message teams, but also what they do after the season is over as well. Now, unlike Europe, a lot of the countries in the Americas are actually known for their shorter seasons. And when we're looking at the Americas, we're typically looking at about 3 to 5 months in general. That is the average of how long a season in the Americas will go for. But again, the top divisions in the Americas, so Brazil, Argentina, Uruguay, Chile, I believe is another. All of those leagues will run for a longer duration. They will run in the traditional basketball sense for 7 to 9 months. Outside of those leagues, outside of those top leagues, if you're a beginning player or if you're a rookie or an entry-level player or a middle-level player, then you're looking at about 3 to 5 months. And as well, the interesting thing about the Americas is that a lot of these seasons will run during the summertime. They'll run during the off-season, quote-unquote, or a summer season. So some great examples, Canada, they have the CEB. And this is actually how they've marketed themselves as a summer league. So players will play in their traditional European basketball schedules from October to June, and then they'll come home for about June, July, August, around there, and they'll play in the summer season just basically as a way to be home, gain money, play in front of the hometown fans, and then they'll be back. When their traditional season starts up again in October, September, they're gone again. And the same thing happens in Puerto Rico, one of the best countries, one of the best leagues in the Americas. They adopt the same thing. Same thing in Nicaragua, one of the best leagues in Central America. Same thing with Panama, one of the best leagues in Central America. So this is something that's really adopted by a lot of these countries. Now, the second thing you have to be on the lookout for in the Americas is that a lot of these countries will actually run 2 seasons in the same country. So for instance, the opening season will be called Apertura. The closing season will be called Clausura. Now, both leagues may only, but together, both of them are going to run for 8 months. Because if you have 2 seasons and they both run for 3 or 4 months, then together, how much is that? 8 months in total. So it will equal the same that what you would have played in Europe, but there's that break in between. So that's something that you also have to be on the lookout for, is understanding when these leagues are running and if there's 2 leagues running per season. So for instance, the Dominican Republic is one country that has 2 leagues running in the same year. El Salvador is another one. Panama was recently discussing to also have an Apertura and Clausura. This is something that you have to be on the lookout for because you'll have multiple opportunities to actually land in a country in the same year. Now, in contrast to the European season, the Americas really varies a lot in terms of how its in season schedule is. So you'll have a shorter season generally, again, 3 to 5 months, and you'll usually have less practices because you're actually playing more games. And this can be a good and bad thing depending on the player you are, you know, how you're built, whatever, how your body is, your age. There's a million factors, right? But in general, you will usually be playing about 2 to 4 games per week in the Americas. And so this is all coming down to preference. In Europe, as I mentioned, you're only going to be playing about 1 game, if you're lucky, 2 games per week. So if you screw up on that game, then you have a whole week going through practice, waiting for a chance to redeem yourself. And say you screw up too many times, maybe 2, 3 weeks, that may be it. That may be curtains for you, and they're getting the next guy in line. Whereas in the Americas, you may screw up on Friday, but have a back-to-back. The next day, you're back at it. And then you may be playing on Monday again. So, you know, by the time that Monday games comes around, if you kill it in Saturday and Monday, they're not even going to be thinking about that Friday game anymore. But in general, these are the differences between Europe and the Americas. Now, when we get to Asia, this is kind of, if Latin America is a shorter season, looking at 3 to 5 months, and Europe is the longer season, looking at about 7 to 9 months, 8 to 9 months around there, then Asia is somewhere in between. Again, it's going to follow the same principle as I mentioned earlier about how the top teams always will have a longer season. So in China, the CBA, they have a longer season for about 7 to 8 months around there. In Japan, in the B League, it's the same deal. In South Korea, I believe it's around 6 to 7 months. But then there are also a few of these shorter leagues that actually run in the summertime, very similar to Latin America. In Hong Kong, the first division, it's usually going to run about in the summertime. In Vietnam, it's also going to run in the summertime. Another one is Malaysia. Now you have to understand something when I say during the summertime as well. A lot of these leagues, the month that it actually starts in, doesn't matter where, in Europe, Asia, Latin America, doesn't matter. the month that it starts will vary. It will vary for a million reasons, right? Maybe the teams are funded by the government. Maybe there was an election, so they had to move it back a bit. Maybe the team owners just couldn't get their act in order by the time the league wanted to start. There's a million reasons why it could change. The month will change slightly, but the duration of the season usually will not change that much. So if a league is usually going for about 5 to 7 months, it may not start in October, it may start in November, the next year it may start in September, but it will still probably go for that 5 to 7 months. So that's something you have to keep in mind. This is just a general outline of what you can basically expect in each continent and how you can tailor and contact each team depending on when the season starts. And finally, in Australia, it's basically always going to be a 5 to 6 month season. This seems to be very concrete, very set in stone. Regardless of whether you're playing in the NBL, which is the top division there, or they have a lot of state leagues there where they have teams within various states, that would be considered the lower divisions of Australian pro basketball. But for the most part, it's always going to follow about 5 months in Australia. So with all of this information now at your fingertips, what can you do with it? It's important that you don't just listen to when the dates start, but you understand the psychology of teams when they're actually looking for players, when they're not looking for players, when they may be in a bind, when they may be switching out players. This is all going to impact the likelihood of you actually getting signed. Pretty much you just want to give yourself a fighting chance. And if you're contacting teams when they're not even looking for players, constantly contacting them during the wrong time frame, during the wrong time period, then you're going to get frustrated and you're probably going to stop eventually doing what you do just because you're never getting a positive response from them. So you have to understand when the leagues run, when they don't run, when they're looking for teams, when they're not looking for teams, and understand the length, duration of each season so that you can adjust appropriately. Now, I wrote a blog post on this where I went through the full breakdown in a lot more detail. I'll link that in the description below. If you guys want to learn more about overseas basketball and what it's like, all of these little tricks and tips that I've learned throughout the years, then go ahead and like and subscribe. It'll help grow the channel a lot. And share this with anyone who you think would benefit from this, someone who's maybe been bumping their head against the wall for the past few weeks, for the past few years trying to get overseas. Maybe this could be the thing that helps edge them in the right way. Anyway, guys, thanks so much for tuning in. I really appreciate it. Like, subscribe, take care, God bless, and keep on the grind. Peace.